Good morning. Good to see everyone in worship today. I'm glad you're here. If you're a guest with us, we're especially glad that you're here this morning and want to offer to you just our the best welcome that we know how. We're glad that you're here today. If you have prayer concerns, we would love to be in prayer with you, so please fill out the card that is there before you in the pews, and we'd love to be in prayer with you. You can hand those to our ushers, either in our greeting time here in a few moments or after the service, and we'll be sure to join you in prayer. Let's take a look at a few announcements. You can find the insert that's there in your with your bulletin. I'd like to highlight a couple of those things. One is that we're looking for Vacation Bible School volunteers as we make preparations for the last week of June. Aaron is in charge of our VBS again this year, and we want to continue to strengthen and grow that ministry. There's a lot of different ways that you can help out. You can be in charge of a station where the different kids go to in those rotations. You can be one of the folks who is helping kind of get the kids in their groups from place to place. You can help out with registration. You can help out in the kitchen. There's a whole variety of ways that you can volunteer and be a part of that. And so I invite you to contact Aaron and let her know that what you'd be interested in, find a place of service there. Also, our Easter egg hunt is coming on Easter Sunday. It'll be right after worship. We'll gather for Sunday school and for worship. Worship 10 o'clock as usual. And immediately following the worship service, we'll have our Easter egg hunt. So you can bring candy to help for stuffing eggs to the church office, and we'll appreciate that. And also bring those kids and grandkids. And if you see kids wandering around the streets of Dayton, invite them to come to church on Easter Sunday and to Vacation Bible School and bring them to the egg hunt, okay? All right. If you're a member of Administrative Council, tomorrow night we're meeting at 6 o'clock, just as a reminder, and we need you there, so please plan on attending. Methodist Men and Methodist Women's meetings are this Tuesday here, the first Tuesday of the month, and so we invite the men and women to be a part of those respective groups. And this coming Saturday is the golf tournament. We've had a great turnout so far. We've got a lot of teams. I think if we're not full, we're very close to it. And so if you talk to John, if you're available this Saturday to help out in any way, and if he has any extra jobs that we just need doing, then I'm sure he'd appreciate the help. All right, at this time, let's stay. Oh, wait, no, I've got one more thing I wanted to report back from last time. Sorry about that. I faked you out a little bit. Last week, we put out a call for folks to help out with a wheelchair ramp project that came Chuck's way. He kind of checked it out and verified what needed to happen there. And thanks to, let's see, I don't want to forget anybody, Bob Sanders and Lynn Sturrock and John Vance and Chuck last week got the supplies, all got there, started working, and as of yesterday, it's finished. It looks fantastic, and she's got a new ramp for herself and for like any people who come to kind of give care for her during the week as well. So thank you for your support, and guys, thank y'all for doing that work this week. We appreciate it. All right, at this time, let's stand and greet one another in the name of Christ.
Stay standing for the call to worship. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. Let us worship the Lord, whose word gives joy to the heart and to the light of the eyes. Please join in the opening prayer found in your bulletin. Almighty God, may the words of our mouths and song and prayer and the meditation of our hearts upon your word and sacrament be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and redeemer. In the name of Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen.
Our opening hymn this morning is found in your hymnal on page 368. Let's sing together, My Hope is Built.
Today, of course, is a communion Sunday, and so as we come to our time of prayer, we come to a time of preparing to come to the Lord's table. Whenever we come to the Lord's table, we remember that this table does not belong to our congregation or to our denomination. The table belongs to Christ. It's his. And so Christ gives his invitation to all who are gathered here. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin, and who seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us join together on page 12. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. And now, as forgiven and reconciled children of God, let us be bold to pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we want to pause and give God thanks as we acknowledge our offering. So let us pray. O Lord, we give you thanks for your gracious provision in our lives. And we give you thanks for the opportunity to participate with you in the ministry and work of our church by supporting it. Lord, receive these tithes and offerings that we bring. Bless them and use them to build up your kingdom through the ministry and the work of our church. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please remain standing for our affirmation of faith found on 881. I believe in the God, the Father Almighty, making of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of the God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Children, will you come forward? It's now your time for Children's Moment.
got something for each of you. Miss Sydney, you better come on down. Come on. Anybody read what that says? It says a ticket redeemed for one surprise after church. Oh, yes, it does. I told you, Miss Sydney, you'd be glad you came down. Okay, so I'm going to ask Mr. John to come on out. Wait, you see Mr. John waving his hand? Okay, wave at him. Okay, you're going to redeem. Oh, gosh, that's a big word, redeem. That means to swap out. You're going to give him your ticket after church if you've been very good, and he's going to give you a surprise as you walk out. Isn't that pretty cool? You know, I like tickets because they let us do a lot of things. Like, for instance, going to the movies. How many of y'all have ever gone to the movies? Yeah. And you have to buy a ticket, right? But with that buying of the ticket comes a little bit of a behavior thing. So when you get in the movie theater, you have to be very quiet. You can't play with your phones or cell phones, right? Has anybody ever been on an airplane? You have? Okay, you have to buy a ticket for that. And again, that comes with some kind of behaviors, right? For example, when you get there, you give them your airline ticket. You go in, and you have to put your seat belt on, right? And stay in your seat. Those are the rules. Well, you know what? Yes, Miss Jessica gave you a ticket, and that's pretty cool today. But I'm going to tell you about the best ticket ever that you're ever going to receive. You ready? It's a ticket that Jesus gives us. It's a ticket to heaven. Whoa. But here's the catch. There's two things. Jesus died on the cross for us so that we have the opportunity to go to heaven, right? But we have to do two things. One, we have to accept that ticket. And two, we've got to live a really good, Christian, loving, kind life. Two things. We can do that, right? Yeah. So that's the best ticket you're ever going to get. And Jesus bought that ticket for us. Will you remember that? So anytime you go somewhere, a movie, a sporting event, a play, a museum, anytime you go and somebody gives you a ticket, I want you to say, thank you, Lord, for Jesus' gift. Will you always remember that? We got to do two things, accept his gift and then live a good life, right? Let's bow and pray. Repeat after me. Dear Lord, thank you for giving us the ticket to heaven. Help us to accept Jesus' gift and help us to live a life of love, kindness, and be a good Christian. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, be good now so you can get your surprise.
All right. Was anybody else tempted to kind of wander down to the steps a few minutes ago? I thought about it. I thought about it the whole time, and I said, hey, should I do that? Thank you, musicians, for how you bless us every week. I ought to say that every week. If I ever miss it, don't think I don't mean it. But it's so I really appreciate everything y'all bring. John and the choir and Laura, beautiful this morning. Our scripture this morning is Matthew chapter 13, beginning in verse 47. We've been looking at the parables of the kingdom from this chapter where Jesus is teaching both kind of crowds and disciples at different points. And he's teaching about the kingdom of heaven. Now, the thing that's important about the kingdom is, one, that it is led by someone who came and who died upon the cross for us. And so the kingdom of heaven is not necessarily like or earthly kingdoms, because the king is someone who gave his life for us. It's an upside down kind of kingdom, but Jesus teaches through these, and today we come to the final parable, the parable of the net. So let's take a look in verse 47. Once again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was let down into the lake and caught all kinds of fish. When it was full, the fishermen pulled it up on the shore. Then they sat down and collected the good fish in baskets, but threw the bad away. This is how it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Oh Lord, we give you thanks for your word made flesh in your son Jesus Christ, and for your word in the scriptures through which you reveal yourself to us. And we pray in these moments together that you would speak your word, that you would write your word upon our hearts by the power of your Holy Spirit at work among us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So John Wesley was the founder of the Methodist movement. He was a priest in the Church of England, but he sensed a need for revival. He experienced revival in his own life. He had sought after God and experienced revival personally. And so then he gave himself to a calling to seek revival in the nation of England and among the Church of England. He remained a faithful clergyman, Anglican priest his entire life. Although the movement that he started started out as a reform and renewal movement in the Church of England, eventually made its way to America and around the world, and became what was the Methodist or the Wesleyan movement. To equip the preachers for his for this work and for the people that he would send out, both the ordained priests, clergy persons, and the lay people he would send out to preach and to call people to repentance and to respond to the gospel, he gave them three books that they were to carry around with all the time. One, they needed to have a Bible, okay? So that should be obvious to us, but you know, they needed to have a Bible, number one. Number two, he gave them a book of hymns, which had hymns to sing and lead the people in and some prayers in it. And he also gave them a copy of a book of standard sermons that he had preached at various occasions, sometimes written out, and he had preached different times. But he gave them that so they would know what the most important things were to preach and how to understand what was being taught of the scriptures. So it was kind of a way to say, these are the beliefs that we understand from the scriptures, and this is what you ought to be preaching. So he gave them that. At the very beginning of that, he wrote a preface to it to kind of give them some guiding words. And from that, we learn a couple of things about Wesley, and we hear something, for me, that's really important to remember. He said, "I am an arrow that has been let loose, and I'm flying through the air." And he said, "I'll only be flying through the air for a little while, just one lifetime, and I want to know one thing." Wesley really wanted to boil it down. He said, "I want to know one thing, the way to heaven, how to land safe on that happy shore." See, he knew that he was going to be out there for a certain amount of time, and at some point, there was going to be a day when he would drop into, as he said, an unchangeable eternity, and he wanted to know how to land safe on that happy shore. What is the way to heaven? That's what he wanted to know. And then what he said to make sure his preachers understood was, he said, I want to know one thing, the way to heaven, and God has made it known to us. He has written it into a book. He said, let me be a man of one book. Wesley was very learned. He'd read thousands of books. But he said, of all the books I've read, I want one to shape my heart, mind, and soul completely, and that is the Bible. Make me a man of one book. And so what Wesley was getting at, of course, is a question that most people need to consider if they haven't already. And as we turn to this parable, the net, it's very short, it's simple, and it's straightforward. And of these parables, as I've been preaching through them this past several weeks, different ones have been challenging in different ways. And this was a challenging one to turn to, and I've been seeing it coming for a little while now. And I was thinking, well, how do we want to come at this parable? Well, so let's look at it for a moment. The parable is about the net. More accurately, to give us a more vivid picture, we might say a dragnet. Because what's happening is he's speaking to people who know something about fishing. Remember, he's already called the disciples, some of them, from careers in fishing, where he said, drop your nets and follow me. And that's what they did. They let him go and they went off after him. They weren't fishing with a rod and reel. They were fishing in bulk, so they had the net going, and he refers to back to it in this parable. The net, if we want to picture it, is essentially something that's got weights on the bottom so it can sink and that they can drag it. Perhaps there's some floats on the top, cork or something like that, where it keeps it, where it's got a wide swath. There were at least 24 species of fish in the Sea of Galilee, which we would call a lake, Lake Galilee. And so when they pulled the nets and dragged the nets along, they would have it to where it sunk all the way as far down to the bottom, or if they're near enough to the shore, it's all the way maybe scraping the bottom, and they've got the top at the very top, so nothing gets away. And they pull it all in, and they either, if they're out from the shore, they gather it all in and scoop it up and get it into the boat and then haul it to shore. Or if they're near enough to the shore, and maybe in a boat, they could just sweep the whole thing all the way up to the shore and get everything on land. So then they could go through and they could see which were the good fish and the bad fish. Now, not something that's rotten, that's been swimming around, it's caught. But what I read was that they're separating the stuff that is good for eating versus the stuff that you don't want to find on your dinner plate, okay? So, you know, I grew up in Northeast Texas and catfish was a delicacy, and I didn't realize that not everybody thought that those were really good fish they should eat, you know? Some people said they were kind of trashy, and we said, well, we deep fried them, and they worked out just fine, you know? But they would separate the ones that were good for eating from the ones that were not good. Now, Jesus, just to make sure we understand, this is one where he says, now, this is how it will be at the end of the age. There will be a judgment, and everybody's scooped up, and the angels will separate the righteous and the wicked. And he uses that phrase, which some people take literally and some people take as kind of an idiom that was used at the time. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Basically, there will be grief about that judgment, but there will be a judgment. Okay, that's kind of a hard word to hear, right? But that's what Jesus says. So let's take a look at it. I mentioned Wesley because as I read this parable, the thing that's most important to me that I want to see is, how can I be among the righteous? Because like that arrow that Wesley's saying, he is and wants to land safe on that happy shore, and I want to know one thing, the way to heaven. I want to know one thing. I want to know how to be among the righteous. If there's going to be a separation, I want to know how to be among the righteous. And here's what I want to say, just kind of looking at our understanding of the whole of Scripture and our reflection on all that the Bible teaches. One prefacing kind of thought is that it seems like more and more uncomfortable with a final judgment these days. It's a hard passage to read, but it's important, and there's a good thing about the fact that there will be a final judgment. Because if there's no judgment, then what that means is that right and wrong never really mattered that much after all. Because we all know that there are things that are right and things that are wrong. There are things that are just and unjust, that are true and that are wicked. And we also know a very hard truth about this life, is that justice doesn't always get served in this life. That's one of the things that we mean when we say life isn't fair. Now, oftentimes we're saying it about something that might be kind of trivial when we put it in perspective with other things, but there's a lot of things in life that are simply deeply, deeply unfair. And The fact that there is a judgment says that the things that happen that are unjust never escape the eye of God, and that there is a justice in His kingdom ultimately. So how do I know that I can be among the righteous, and I can be saved and kept and not thrown out, right? That's what I want to know. Well, in our theology, in our understanding of the scriptures, there's basically kind of two kinds of righteousness that that we talk about in Christian understanding. One, and you don't have to remember the words, I just want you to remember the ideas. One is imputed righteousness, and one is imparted righteousness. Now, I said the big theological words, so you don't have to remember, but here's the idea. Imparted one is the righteousness, or the imputed righteousness is the righteousness that is just a gift. It's given to us, we don't deserve it, we don't earn it, and it's Jesus giving His righteousness to us as a gift, so that when God sees us, He sees us through the lens of Jesus and His grace in our lives. I've told this story before, but a few times I'll repeat illustrations if they're ones that I kind of want you to have as a way to understand it. But there's that this goofy little Christmas movie about the younger brother of Santa's. You know, Santa's got two kids, and one's about to take over when Santa retires, and the younger brother is excited and hopes he gets to do it and loves Christmas and everything. Well, at the beginning of that movie, the elves are coming. It's very high tech, and they've got their SWAT team gear, and they're swinging through ropes, and they're swinging into kids' rooms and filling up stockings, and they've got what looks like a big a big gun that has a barrel on it, but it dispenses toys, okay? So what they do is they take a scanner like at the checkout, and they hold it up to the child's head while he's sleeping or she's sleeping, and it does a readout. And if you're over 50%, it goes green, and it says 81% good, and then they adjust the level of the toy dispensing gun to 81%, and you get what you deserve, right? Because you were 81% good, you get 81% of whatever presents they've got in the thing. So they do this a couple of times, and one of the elves swings into the room. He's good to go. He pulls his gloves off and takes his goggles up, and he gets that scanner up, and he puts it right next to the child's head, and it reads out, and it says 37%. Uh-oh. Red, naughty, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? Well, he's kind of nervous. He doesn't want to not give him presents. He doesn't want to put coal in the stocking. But he has to do what the thing says. And so what he does is he takes the scanner and he points it at his own head, and it pops all the way up to 100% good. And he dispenses the toys for the child, not based on the child's goodness or righteousness, but on his own. Now, it's a silly little movie and kind of a silly scene, but that is essentially what we mean when we say imputed righteousness or gifted righteousness, is that Jesus takes His perfect righteousness and He gives it to us as a gift, so that when God comes to, when there's the final judgment and God is looking at us, He measures out not based on our own qualifications or resume or goodness or whatever, or however we've tried to work the scale. He measures it on Christ's gift of His righteousness to us, so that we don't get what we deserve, percent, whatever, that doesn't come into anything. We get all of the belonging, the fellowship, and membership in the family of God, reconciliation with God, forgiveness, all the gifts of God, new life, new birth, a new beginning, everything we get because of who Christ is and not who we are. That's one kind of righteousness. And there's a second one too. The second one is imparted righteousness, and here's what that means. You don't have to remember the word, but if you've got the righteousness that comes as a gift, where God sees us according to what Christ has done for our behalf and who Christ is, that's one. But here's the other one. is that it's grace that works in us to make us what we've been declared to be in Christ. So that we may be 37% naughty or 10%, or we may be 70, whatever, I don't know, but it doesn't matter where. But the point is that God's grace comes to work in our life, not just to forgive us and to give us a fresh start, but to help us to become like Christ and truly bear the image of God, to grow up. So we might call that what we talk about as maturing grace, that we would mature into righteousness, and so that it's given to us as a gift, but the purpose of that is not to leave us where we are, but to start us on a life of maturing into that righteousness that's proclaimed about us. Christ comes to give us his righteousness, but also to make us like himself, and that's a work of grace. That's a work of grace. Grace begins at forgiveness, but it doesn't end at forgiveness. Grace begins at forgiveness and concludes in maturing us fully into the image of God, which is Christ-likeness. That's what that righteousness is. There's two righteousnesses that God's wanting to work in our lives. Now, how do I become righteous? How do I get counted among the righteous? Well, I want to embrace and receive the whole of God's grace. The whole of God's grace. I'm embracing the righteousness that comes as a full gift because that's the only way I can stand before God. But I also want to embrace the righteousness and the grace that comes to mature me in faith because that's God's desire for me and that's how he designed me in the first place. That's God's original intent, and it's his final intent for me is to become fully an image bearer like Jesus. That's the righteousness that God wants from me. And to be very practical for just a couple of moments, how can we grow in that righteousness that we become more Christ-like? There's all kinds of ways that we could talk about. But I want to give us an image of the sculptor who is working with that raw material, marble or whatever it is, a wood carver carving the wood, a potter working with the raw clay, whichever you want to use, whatever artisan that you kind of resonate with, but that sculptor who is chipping away and chipping away and chipping away and sanding and rounding out and making everything look just perfectly. Imagine that those are the things that we do that God uses to mold our character, to mold our attitudes, to mold our actions. So the things that we do are not things that we do to earn God's favor, but they're things that we do to participate in God's grace, chipping and carving and making us more like him. So that we're people who, as Jesus said and quoted from the Old Testament, love the Lord our God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. Most days, I'm doing good to love the Lord my God with some of my heart, mind, soul, and strength. Right? Anybody else? Don't raise your hand. I want to. I like the idea of it. But I wake up in the morning. And then something happens. And I stub my toe. And I get frustrated with somebody or whatever. And all that loving God with everything I've got kind of gets like, okay, ding, 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 ding. Some of my heart, mind, soul, and strength. But I want to love the Lord my God with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. And that's what Jesus wants for us too. So what can we do to mold and shape our heart, our mind, our soul, our strength to be loving him with everything we've got? And essentially, it's the things that you already know. But there's a way that I want us to start talking about them more and more prevalently as a congregation. So that when we say, are we fully engaged in the life of the church, in the life of putting myself in a position where grace can do its work in me. And that's worshiping, studying, serving, and giving. Worshiping, serving, studying, and giving. When we worship, we come and we open our hearts to not be thinking about ourselves and our problems only, but we put ourselves before God to worship and praise him because he's worthy of it, number one. Why come to church? Why show up to worship? Well, the number one reason is God. Because he's worth us showing up and giving him our praise and our glory. And when we do that collectively, we do it in worship. When we do it privately, we do it in prayers. But to worship, that shapes, when we do that, it shapes something about us. It helps us orient our heart, orient our mind towards God. But maybe I can love, do a little bit better at loving God with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. Maybe I'm doing it with a little bit more of that this week than it was last week. And in a year, I start to look back and I see, you know what, that has really oriented my whole life in a way that's pointing me more towards Christ-likeness. So we worship, we study. I remember one of my seminary professors saying that at the time, you could either take these two, you know, these classes in Greek to fulfill that requirement for New Testament study, or if you had studied it and you knew it, then you could test out of it. And he had a student once who went and took the exam and just failed it royally and was shocked. And he came to him and said, well, I don't know what happened. And he said, well, didn't you study? And he said, well, I thought it was something that was just kind of intuitive. And he was like, are you kidding me? You know? To grow in Christ's likeness, it helps to study, to open up the Word. We try to do that in our sermon time. We'll open the scriptures together, but it's important to do that in Sunday school, in Bible study, in private study, however you want to do it, but it does help to do it in community. So sometime each year, it's important for everybody to participate in some kind of experience of studying the Word together with some others. It shapes our mind. It helps us learn new things. It helps us continue to grow and mature in our understanding, which also shapes our heart and our actions too. They all reinforce one another. Serving, it's important to go out and to serve and to give our lives in service to others outside of ourselves. We've got so many great examples of that in our congregation, and there's always more opportunities that we can do. We've got ways to serve internally, to serve the life of the church, the life of the congregation, whether it's serving in worship in our choir, in our liturgy, in our communion serving, our communion stewards, ushers, media, all those different things, serving in Sunday school classes, Bible studies, all that sort of stuff. We've also got ways to serve that point outward in terms of ministries to the community and MOPS and in the Society of St. Stephen's and our food pantry and our Dayton ISD luncheon that we put on every year and Friends Indeed and start naming things, and I'm afraid I'm going to leave something out. So if I've left something out, I'm sorry. But there's so many things that we do that point outward, that press outward. Pumpkin Patch, you know, when you come and when you serve at Pumpkin Patch, it raises money, but we put that into ministries that we have that serve outward in the community and into ministries that we see in the community that we want to help support. And we've been able to make a difference because of doing that. You wouldn't remember it, you wouldn't think it, but we've been able to do that. We serve not only to be part of what God's kingdom is doing, but also because when we do that, it does something in our heart. It's the sculptor taking that and chiseling away a little bit of something in me that is more self-centered than it is God-centered. More self-reference than it is to me pointing outward to what God, who God is and what God wants to see in people's lives happen. And then giving. Giving is kind of like serving. It's us parting with something that we want to hold on to in order to be a part of what God's doing. In serving, it's our time and our energy. In giving, it's our money and our resources. Jesus said, where your treasure is, your heart will be also. One of the little truths that has helped me as much as anything in my journey of giving myself has been that. Because the insight is that heart follows treasure, not the other way around. So when we give our treasure to God as a part of that, then our heart follows even more so. It's kind of like serving. We can't think about it and it do something for us. When we do it, it has a shaping factor in our lives. So to go back, how do we land safe on that happy shore like Wesley? He's written it in a book. He's told us about the gospel of Jesus' righteousness for us and his righteousness that he wants to grow in us to mature in grace. The righteous are those who embrace and accept all of the grace that God wants to work in our lives. Forgiveness is the beginning. There's a scene in the book, the play, the movie, Les Miserables, where the prisoner, the main character, and I don't know, you know, it's always one of those where it's hard to know how you should pronounce it. The East Texas version would be Jean Valjean, right? But I think if I'm trying to be French, it's Jean Valjean, but that sounds a little funny to say. Anyway, well, anyway, he is in need. A bishop allows him to come and is gracious to him. But in his desperation and kind of knowing what he, like, sometimes we just do the things we know how to do, not the things that we ought to do. And what he knew how to do was to take some of the silver of the in the bishop's house and run away with it in the night to try and resell it and get money to help get himself down the way later. Well, he's captured by the authorities and brought back to the bishop. He's put before him, and he says, "Here we found him. This is what he's got." And the bishop said, "Oh yes, I actually know about that. He was in such a hurry that he didn't receive my whole gift. You forgot to take the silver candlesticks and utensils as well when you took the other things." And they released him to the bishop's authority because there were no charges to press. The bishop had shown him an incredible act of grace and forgiveness. Now, here's the thing. None of us would think that story was worth anything if the man received those and as soon as the authorities were away, knocked out the bishop and ran off with him again. We all expect that that act of forgiveness ought to consummate in a transformed heart and a life set on a new path so that he might, on the one hand, be declared as forgiven, and at the same time that might be a catalytic event where he lives into the person that forgiveness declares him to be. So, there is a judgment. There is a judgment. The net brings in all. But here's the good news of the gospel is all are offered the grace of Jesus. And the righteous are the ones who embrace and receive all of what that grace wants to do, to both forgive and transform. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your grace in Jesus Christ, although we often underestimate it. Help us to receive not only your grace of forgiveness, but also your grace in transformation. Do a work in our hearts, in our minds, in our soul, in our body, in our strength, all every part of us, that we would be wholehearted, completely yours. Help us give ourselves to those simple, practical things of worshiping, studying, serving, giving, life in a congregation, so that you would use the raw material of those activities, and that you would use it to transform and mature us until we grow up in Christ. To your glory, amen. The sacrament of Holy Communion is called the sacrament of sanctification. It is that sacrament whereby we connect with that maturing grace. You are what you eat. And we want to feed on more of Jesus so that we can become more like him. That's what the sacrament means. And so let's embrace that grace together as well. If you would continue with me in the hymnal on page 13 at the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth, and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Would those who are assisting in serving communion come forward at this time? Table is ready. Would you come at the direction of the ushers?
Thank you.
have responded to the grace of Christ, go forth to be people of grace in his name. Amen. Christ, we have the hope of everlasting life in him. Go forth to be a people of hope in his name. Amen. Christ, we have peace with God. Go forth to be a peacemaker in his name. have received the grace of God in Jesus Christ, go forth to be a person of grace in His name. You turn in your bulletins to the back page and join me in the prayer after receiving communion. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's stand together as we prepare to sing our closing hymn. Now go forth with this blessing and benediction. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of His Holy Spirit at work among you. Go in the peace, the power, and the presence of Christ to be His witnesses. Amen.